First part of the lecture to this verse, because this verse actually fits very well to the second part, because it describes the character of a pure devotee, such as Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur. So let's focus on the first part for now, in the verse. I read the verse, please repeat. Bhavadvida Bhagavatas. That's the verse, right?
1:13:10.
Bhavadvida Bhagavatas. Tirtha Bhuta Swayam Vibho. Tirthi Kurvanti Tirthani. Svantastina Gabda Britta Bhavadvida Bhagavatas Tirtha Bhuta Swayam Vibho Tirtha Kurvanti Tirthani Svantastina Gabda Britta Svantastina Gabda Britta Bhavadvidi Bhagavatas Tirtha Bhuta Swayam Vibho Tirthi Kurvanti Tirthani Svantastina Gadabrita Bhavat, you good self, Vidha, like, Bhagavataha, devotees. Tirtha, the holy place of pilgrimage. Bhutaha, converted into. Swayam, personally. Vibho, O powerful one. Tirthi Kurvanti, make into a holy place of pilgrimage. Tirthani, the holy places. Svantastena, having been situated in the heart, Gadabrita, the personality of Godhead. My Lord, devotees like your good self are verily holy places personified. Because you carry the supreme personality of Godhead within your heart, you turn all places into places of pilgrimage. It's a glorious verse, and particularly to read today on the appearance of Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur. And it should be read on all the appearance day of great acharyas, like Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati or Srila Prabhupada, in fact, because that's exactly what these personalities do. Because they carry the personality of God in their heart, they turn all places into places of pilgrimage. You see this Prabhupada, he did that. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he did that. Bhaktisiddhanta also established so many places of pilgrimage. You go to any place where Lord Chaitanya has been in his transcendental pastimes, Lord Srila Bhaktisiddhanta established the footprints and temples. And we will hear about that later, how this all connects. Purport by Srila Prabhupada, the personality of God that is omnipresent by his diverse potencies everywhere, just like the power of electricity is distributed everywhere within space. Yeah. Similarly, the Lord's omnipresence is perceived and manifested by his unalloyed devotees like Vidura, just as electricity is manifested in electric bulb. A pure devotee like Vidura always feels the presence of the Lord everywhere. He sees everything in the potency of the Lord and the Lord in everything. The holy places all over the earth are meant for purifying the polluted consciousness of the human being by an atmosphere surcharged with the presence of the Lord's unalloyed devotees. If anyone visits a holy place, he must search out the pure devotees residing in such holy places, take lessons from them, try to apply such instructions in practical life, and thus greatly prepare oneself for the ultimate salvation, going back to Godhead. To go to some holy place of pilgrimage does not only mean to take a bath in the Ganges or Yamuna, or visit the temples situated in those places. I should also find representatives of Vidura who have no desire in life save and except to serve the personality of Godhead. Personality of Godhead is always with such pure devotees because of the unalloyed service, which is without any tinge of fruitive action or utopian speculation. They are in the actual service of the Lord, specifically by the process of hearing and chanting. The pure devotees hear from the authorities and chant, sing and write of the glories of the Lord. Mamuni Vyasadeva heard from Narada and then he chanted in writing. Sukadeva Goswami similarly studied from his father and he described it to Parikshit. In this way, that is the way of Srimad Bhagavatam. So by the actions, the pure devotees of the Lord can render any place into a place of pilgrimage. And the holy places are worth the name only on their account. Such pure devotees are able to rectify the polluted atmosphere of any place, and what to speak of a holy place rendered unholy by the questionable actions of interested people who try to adopt a professional life at the cost of the reputation of a holy place. Granjana Shalakaya Chakshunamitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namah Sri Chaitanya Manovistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Svayam Rupa Ramayam Dadati Svaparantikam Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasudeva Gaur Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama By the grace of Bhaktivinod Thakur, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta was born. By the grace of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, Srila Prabhupada went all over the world. And established so many temples all over the world. And his followers continued to do so. This one sentence caught my attention, that the Lord can render any place into a place of pilgrimage. The holy places are worth the same only on their account. Such pure devotees are able to rectify the polluted atmosphere of any place, and what to speak of a holy place rendered unholy by the questionable actions of interested persons who try to adopt a professional life at the cost of the reputation of a holy place. I remember, just to give you a classical example, some or other, by the mercy of Prabhupada and Krishna, we were able to buy this place in island in the middle of a lake. It came on the market in the morning, and I saw it. We happened to go into exactly that town. We had no idea, except that we wanted to establish Krishna in a very beautiful place. That was my promise, actually, when I originally bought that deity in Jaipur to Govinda Ji. And so Govinda Ji arranged it, that at that very moment it came. It's a whole long history, why, reaching over long period, decades of time, why it came to this moment of sale. It's completely transcendental. I mean, so many things happen, I don't want to go into that, but I can feel in the evening how many historical events led to exactly this moment that I walked into the city where this temple came on the market. It's a long, very fascinating story, actually. But now, later on, we saw that all these things fit together. Things that happened 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, 100 years ago. And everything was summed up by the words of the Earl of Erne, the eminent aristocrat of the area, who owns enormous amount of land and has an enormous castle. And I invited him and the Earl of Lanesborough for lunch. And after that, they came into the temple. And this Lord Ernst said, it's a very significant sentence, he said, to his friend, the Earl of Lanesborough, both being lords, aristocrats, he said, "And do you remember Henry, when we were sitting here, 50 years ago, drinking port, alcohol?" He said, "Who would imagine that this would turn into a Hindu mandir 50 years later?" These people have been in touch with India, English aristocracy. They know what a temple is called mandir. And so that was a fact. It was a polluted place. You know, it was a place for alcohol, for parties of the aristocracy, securely enjoying each other and themselves on an island in the middle of a lake, surrounded by castles. There are many castles there of different aristocrats. In fact, the whole British aristocracy had a home there. And they would come for summer, and even Winston Churchill came and visited this Inishrath and the house of the British Viceroy on the other side of the shore, which is now the temple's property. It's amazing, from the Viceroy to Radha Govinda as being the next owner. This is how that happened, actually. It's very significant if you think about it. British Viceroy's house was destroyed by terrorists and left unkept for a long time. And the government didn't want to sell it. Till we appeared on the scene, and 2 weeks after we were able to move onto the island, this property came for sale. And the previous owner called me, "My God, now it comes for sale. I would have bought it for the last 20 years. Can you go back on the contract for the island?" And I said, "We have become too attached to this property." I said, "It's too late." So we bought it. And so we can see how, in this particular case that I'm aware of, hundreds of years came to a culmination that it became the home of Radha Govinda. Hundreds of years. So many incidents. Some incidents very violent. Very violent incidents led actually to this situation that we could secure this property, because the Lordship desired to reside there. It is has become the spiritual heart of all of Ireland. And we cannot understand how these arrangements are arranged. That's why nobody can understand Krishna's plan. Bhishma said, on the bed of arrows, "You cannot." You know, it's just like in the life of the Hare Krishna movement, you know. Who could imagine that from Lord Chaitanya all the way it would lead to Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur, and then to Bhakti Siddhanta, and then ultimately to Srila Prabhupada, who was predicted even in the time of Lord Chaitanya, that the Lord's plans are very long-lasting, and the foundations are set in a time that we are not aware of even. We are not even around. The foundation is set for the birth of the Hare Krishna movement. And so unholy places, I mean, I remember our temple in Montreal. It was a bowling alley, you know, where people play bowling. You know, bowling? There was a bowling alley. And became a temple, our first temple. And then later, I think it was in Montreal, they moved into the temple of a meat-eating congregation of Christians. They built the temple and we moved in. This is the present temple of Fisher Mansion, for example. Fisher Mansion in Detroit is so opulent. I was there for 1 year. I had to do some administration work and preach particularly also. And it is so, every room of the house is different, and it's It's marble from all over the world, different types of marble, different types of columns, sometimes Indian columns, sometimes columns that are built like this. You could not buy such a place. You couldn't. You know, it is inconceivably opulent. Prabhupada was very proud when ISKCON was able to buy it. And there's even a story to it. There was a girl joining in Amsterdam. She wanted to join. I happened to be the president at that time. Just to give you an idea of historicity, how things work, history. So she was there. She came with a hippie friend. And she stayed in the temple, and she had great interest in joining the Hare Krishna movement. When she told me that she is the daughter of a famous personality in America. And I relate this information to our GBC. And he told me that, oh, she's very rich. Bring her here immediately. And so I did that, and he preached to her in a very heavy fashion. How much money do you have? And we need that money. And she was so upset because that preaching was very different from my preaching, actually. I didn't preach like that. You don't ask people for money when they're rich. You just preach to them and let them come in their own time, you know. And anyway, she left. She was very upset. She went to America. And that was a time when Prabhupada came to Detroit. And the temple president, he said, why don't you meet Srila Prabhupada? And she met Srila Prabhupada. And at that time, Prabhupada was seeing this beautiful property. And she, out of herself, offered. He said, Srila Prabhupada, I can pay for that. I can give you a huge donation to that. And in this way, you see our situation in Amsterdam, and ultimately in Frankfurt, where she was blown out with the idea that she went to Detroit, and which is the home of all the big motor corporations at that time, and the home of her father. It was at the very moment that Prabhupada appeared in Detroit. And that money was the seed money. I think Ambarish Prabhu also gave, they both, and it was a big thing in the media at that time in Detroit. That the head of the a member of the Ford Motor Corporation joined together with this lady who was the number one Labour Party Labour Union leader, namely Ruther. So everything is arranged by Krishna. This is how it comes out, you know. That we were able to buy this very precious, beautiful, gorgeous, absolutely, we have never seen such an opulent place. It's like out of 1001 Night, this Arabian story. You know, it was Krishna's arrangement. Krishna wanted to live there, in that castle. So in the same way, Krishna wanted to live on this island. And in so many ways, every temple in ISKCON has some sort of a mystery to it, some mystique to it. Why it came about. And this is all Krishna's arrangement, how he is able to purify through the agency of Srila Prabhupada places that were before places of debauchery, where people would drink and engage in all kinds of unholy activities. They became, by Prabhupada's grace, places of pilgrimage. This is just one little sentence that I took off when I saw that. That Prabhupada was able to do that. That if he would meet people, he would completely transform their life within minutes sometimes. And so don't be surprised that many of us, we just left everything behind. You know, I mean, inconceivable. You know, no future security. Zero future security, and we just followed Prabhupada, you know, because we had faith in him, and we understood if we serve him, then Krishna will take care of us. You know, that was the paradigm, the general paradigm that every one of us followed. You know, that we didn't consider that, What about insurance? What about the future? What about how do you feed your babies? It never crossed our minds. Because we wanted to simply follow Prabhupada's vision to distribute Krishna consciousness all over the world at all costs. At all costs. Even at personal, high personal cost, which is a fact. And so that was the magic of Prabhupada. I mean, think about it. Even the Sri Rangam temple. Where does the money come from, Sri Rangam? That who's the acharya there? It's Sri Sampradaya, is it? Ramanuja. He engaged. He had all kinds of friends. Even robbers would listen to him when he would speak. And there was a big team of robbers were there who became touched by his preaching. And so he told them, he said, you are robbers, professional robbers, and please rob as much money as possible because I want to build this temple. And they did. They did. They robbed anybody who had a penny in their pocket, practically speaking. And this temple was built. And then he saw that, just like Krishna, when he saw that the Yadu dynasty may become a danger to the world because they're so powerful. So in the same way, one day he hired a boat to cross the river. I forgot what river is there. And he bathed in it, Jaitirtha, Prabhu and myself. Huge river, one of the big rivers of India. Kaveri. Definitely hard of hearing. Kaveri. And in the middle of the river, he pulled the plug out of the boat. There was a plug. And the boat sank. And all the robbers drowned. And he walked over the water back to the temple. You see, by hook and by crook, you know, he established this temple, which was not possible in any other way. And so in the same way, Srila Prabhupada, he was very daring and to establish Krishna consciousness. He went to any extent, you know, to publish his books and to establish these temples. Yesterday we saw how he would acquire the deities of Radha Landaneshwara. It was not exactly by the book. It was something he did just to secure these deities. And in the same way, one day when Srila Prabhupada wanted to print the Krishna book, there was no money. And so he told Shamasunda Prabhu, he said, go ask George for money. And Shamasunda said, Prabhupada, I never ask George for money. We shouldn't do that because that's what everybody else is doing. As soon as somebody sees George, he goes to him and said, can you give me some money? That's what happens. He was harassed by people. And Prabhupada said, no, you just do. Krishna will help you. And so he went and he told me this story. Then he went to George's house and there was a famous sculpture. You know the sculpture who makes the faces of the queen for the coins, for example, or any kind of statue of the Queen of England. He was the number one person. I forgot his name. So he was there and they were eating lunch in the evening. And Shamasunda didn't say anything. And George, being very sensitive, I realized this also, he was a very sensitive person. He picked up on it and said, Shamasunda, why don't you talk? Is there something on your mind that you don't want to talk about? He said, well, George, I don't want to be. Please tell it, you know. And so after a lot of heckling, he said, all right, here it is. The Prabhupada wants to print the Krishna book. And it cost $19,000, which was a lot of money at that time. And he said, and he sent me to ask you whether you could pay for it. And George Harrison was in a shock. He put his fork and his knife down, and he said, Shama Sunda. He was very sad. At that time, there was a flash of lightning and an enormous thunder. It shook the whole house and the electricity went out. And they were staying in the dark for a minute. And then the light went on. And George said, well, you cannot really argue with that one. And he pulled out his checkbook and signed the check. You see how Krishna intervened and sent this flash, frightening flash, and immediately thunder, that means it's right there, you know. And it made George change his mind. He said, you cannot argue with that. It's a sign from the top all the way down to here, our house. And he signed the check. And there are many instances where how Prabhupada acquired things and how Prabhupada did things. I could talk about many more of such incidences. How he got, after 3 years of being in America as a penniless pauper living in the Bowery, which is a very run-down place in New York. People, gentlemen, or fine people don't even go there. To be able to print Bhagavad Gita in the biggest publishing house in the world, the Macmillan Company, that's such an achievement, such a huge achievement. It's not possible without Krishna. And Samasunda told us a story how that happened. It was just miraculous how that happened. I tell you another time. And so, you see, by the Prabhupada was able to turn people's hearts. You know, like, I remember I went to this Lady Rothschild. The Rothschild family is one of, besides the Rockefellers, these are the richest people at that time, at least in the world. And the Rothschild family, a huge banking family, Jewish bankers family, they came from Frankfurt and they had their house there. And they had this castle. They bought this castle from the 15th century, which is called the Savior's Court, Rettershof, the place where the saviors live. You know, it was a monastery. And so I was told to find some place, and within no time, I called some contacts from my past in youth organizations, and I called the youth hostel organization. And they said, yes, right now there's a property we intended to buy, but then we backed out because it doesn't suit us. Something better came up. And so I went to this lady in my dhoti, and she was in a shock when she saw me. And I told her to relax, that everything is okay, that I'm a representative of a very old monastic tradition, Indian philosophy, and she became attentive. And so then after preaching to her, straightforward preaching, she agreed to give it to us. And the maintenance, the person who was running it, he was very upset. He said, do you know who these people are? He said, I don't care. I've heard enough. I understand, this is a good cause, you know. And later on, even more astounding, Prabhupada wanted to buy the place, and I went there and negotiated. And she said, I was just thinking the same thing. I said, what's the price? $3 million. And in the preaching of 3 hours, she cut down the price from $3 million to $1 million, which is... And there's no logic in it, you know, it is Krishna's logic. And so there are so many places like this that by the mercy of Prabhupada, by the mercy of this great soul, in the most astounding things are possible. It's not by human... Prabhupada came as an old man. One lord of the House of Lords in London stopped what was his name, Ranchur Prabhu, and said, I had to buy this book, The Life of Prabhupada. He said, I had to buy it because I heard that here's a man with 70 years, he goes to America, 66, at the time when we are all on a cane, just like myself, I'm on the cane, you know. This body is not the same. You know, when I was young, I was dancing in kirtan, leading kirtans and all these things. And now to go to America to start a Hare Krishna movement, this is utopic. This is completely utopic. So Prabhupada went, he said, I'm astounded when I heard that. So I read his book and I can understand this man is an extraordinary person. He said, nobody can do such a thing in the material world. At that age, to establish a worldwide movement with now alone in India 400 temples. Yeah, it's not the devotees, it's the power of Srila Prabhupada that brings all this about. You know, the Shakti, Krishna, Shakti, Vinana. There's this verse that unless one is empowered by Krishna, one cannot preach like that, so effective. It's not possible. And wherever Prabhupada would go, he would change people's hearts, wherever, whether in France, whether in England. Why we were so successful in Britain? Because Prabhupada sent six of his followers. You know, and even yesterday, you know, I saw somebody sent me a picture. You know, let me show you. Here. This has happened just a couple of days before. It's the devotees where they're having kirtan in London, Hainan, and George Harrison. No, Paul McCartney stopped by. Picture is gone. He stopped by, pulled down the window, and talked with him, he's one of the Beatles, you know. 1,250,000,000 dollars he has in his bank account. That's a lot of money, you know. He pulled down the window for the devotees and said, hello. They immediately understand this. And he said, they sold him a book immediately, and he took it. And then, can we make a photo? He said, sure. And so here are these three Sankirtan boys, right? And one of the most famous people in the world, stopping by and allow them to make a photo and waving. This is all Prabhupada's mercy. This is not possible. Otherwise, you know, nobody can stop. Oh, here's a big picture. How did I do that? There you have a big picture. I can send you this picture. It's quite amazing. And so this is all the power of a great personality who has his golden touch. Because he is under Krishna's control. He's under Krishna's control. He is a tool in Krishna's hands. He is a tool. Like we have to become tools. We should not try to practice Krishna consciousness in our own way. We should simply pray to become tools of Prabhupada and ultimately tools of Bhaktisiddhanta, tools of Bhaktivinod Thakur all the way to the Acharyas. That is the way to being able to do something and also the way to happiness. You know, because if the more we come into Krishna's realm, which is full of bliss, the more bliss is there. So, that much as for this verse. Krishna is omnipresent, that means he's everywhere. He's not in the sky only, like religionists in Western countries think, that God is in heaven. He's everywhere, and he's omnipresent, he's omniscient. That means he knows everything. He knows omniscience. Omniscience means he knows everything. The word om is in there. Omniscient, omnipotent, all-powerful, and all-powerful. omnipresent everywhere, omnipotent, all-powerful, and omniscient, that he knows everything. Nothing can be hidden from Krishna. Nothing. He sees everything. By following the instructions of Krishna, and by following the saints and sages, great personalities, parampara, guru, shastra, sadhu, we get in contact with Krishna, and then we can do amazing things. Amazing things. You know, like I can only speak about my generation. So many devotees have done amazing things that are not possible otherwise. You know, they went to London, and within weeks they learned to know the Beatles. And in fact, this famous personality, this Paul McCartney, he bought a house right beside our temple in London, downtown, around the corner, 100 yards. And as an effect of it, he passes by the devotees all the time, every day or whenever he goes into his office there, he has his headquarters there. And many times the restaurant gets an order, Paul McCartney wants to have meal for so many people. And they eat prasadam. You see, I mean, this is all Krishna's mercy, that we were able to secure that place in huge London, and he was able to secure a place right around the corner. And there's a connection there, as you can see here. You know, this is all Krishna's mercy. This is the power of Srila Prabhupada, the power of great souls, the whole atmosphere becomes surcharged by the presence of the Lord's unalloyed devotees. In this way, things are getting done. In this way, things are getting done. In this way, Arjuna was able to conquer thousands and thousands of people. Thousands of people. By the grace of Krishna. And this way, Bhaktisiddhanta was able to meet all kinds of hugely important people. Bhaktivinod Thakur became the custodian, the number one custodian of Jagannath Temple in Orissa. And he was the highest officer of the British government in all of India. The British didn't trust any Indian to be in high position. And he had the highest position of a magistrate for whole Odisha. You know, government. And his power was amazing. This leads us now to a discussion on Bhaktivinod Thakur, if we have that time. We have that time. We must take the time. Today is a special day. This is all possible by the mercy of Krishna and by the mercy of his pure representatives, such as Bhaktivinod Thakur, who we are going to remember today, all the way to Srila Prabhupada. So we are very fortunate, those devoted in the first generation of Srila Prabhupada, fortunate, and those in the second, and any generation follow, you know, as long as they follow Srila Prabhupada's teachings and hold holy what he said. Practically speaking, these books are, in one sense, they're Srila Prabhupada's Vani. And this is Srila Prabhupada Vani. In the absence of the spiritual master, the service is called Vani. So they are Prabhupada's Vani, but they are also at the same time Vapu. Because as we have heard from Chandramouli Maharaj, I gave this example yesterday, I wrote a letter to Garuda Prabhu, who is a professor at Harvard University, top university in the world. And he inherited the whole library, he told me, of this one of the famous professors who trusted him and who reared him in this position. And he pointed out how this printing of Srila Prabhupada, their holy scriptures, and as such, they are untouchable. You can't touch them. You have to just reads them very carefully and preserves them. And Chandramuri's example shows that they're not just Vani, they're also Vapu. That Prabhupada can appear through this. One time Prabhupada said, even if you read only one page of one of my books, then he said, even if somebody reads just one sentence of my books, he said, then even if somebody reads only one word of my writing, his life is deeply touched, because the energy of electricity is everywhere. It's in a light bulb, it's in a washing machine, it's in the fridge, it's in the electricity that drives a huge machine. It's the same energy. So just by touching Prabhupada's words in these books, even just by touching a book like this, you know, I found the best way to distribute is that people touch this book. Like, I give you an example here. Give me a cell phone. I give you an example how I distributed lots of books. By, you go over the street and just hold a little leaflet. It doesn't matter what it is, it can be a sheet of toilet paper. I did it as well, but it had nothing in print. You just, everybody will take a little leaf, right? Everybody. Get up. You know the person, I give you a little demonstration, and watch carefully. So here's a guy that takes a leaf and says, hello, good to meet you. I have a present for you. So he has a book in his hand already. You know? You see how? I tricked him to get this book into his hand, because he touches the book. He is in contact with Krishna at that very moment. It begins. It's the beginning of his spiritual life. Very simple, you know, if you go around with these books and try to distribute them, it's very hard for people to take them. But if you have a little leaflet, you know, just give it, somebody takes it and immediately says, this is for you. And we're distributing today these books to all the intelligent people in town, such as your good self, for example. You know, or I would say, did you see this famous personality just pass by? He said, no. He said, really, what happened? He said, we're distributing today these books to all the intelligent people. It's not related, you know, but just to get him to take this book and have it in his hand. So there is some magic involved when we distribute books, and there's some magic involved when we see how Prabhupada was able to do all this. So there's some magic involved, which is described here, that great souls like Vidura, they have no desire then to in life except to serve Krishna. And that's yesterday I wrote, Prabhupada said, we are not interested in any kind of public worship. If people think being worshipped or recognition, what is the use? If 1,000 asses say you're very good, what is the benefit of that? We want to have a certificate from Krishna that we have satisfied him in our preaching, in our deeds, in our action. And this is the underlying, modus of life, the way how people live. And they're pure devotees of God. They have no desire except to serve Krishna and make Krishna happy. Make Krishna happy. Just like one time Haridas met Lord Chaitanya, and he said, asked Lord Chaitanya if there's anything he can do for him. And Lord Chaitanya said, yes, I'm not very happy, because people in this age are so fallen, how they can actually take to Krishna consciousness. And then Haridas Thakur said, my dear Lord, you know everything, but since you asked me, just by touching the holy name, once even, people have a spiritual life again. It may take time. It may take time. How many people we have given prasadam? It's inconceivable. How many people? And books. Inconceivable. It takes some time. When they come back next life, you have a huge amount of people who are interested in Krishna consciousness, because they ate prasadam in their last life, because they took a book in their last life, because they gave a donation in their last life. Gigantic, gigantic congregation. This is just the first stage, you know. You raise an enormous amount of people who are interested. They see the book, they want it. Or they are born and start chanting. Like we have this boy in Czech Republic, I was told, who is 8 years old and chants every day 64 rounds. How is that possible? 64 rounds. 8 year old boy born in a Karmi family in Czech Republic. How is that possible? This is Prabhupada's power. You know that he certainly touched a book in his last life or did something. Did something. You know, this is just, I'll tell you another story. I have to tell you that story. It's just too good. There was a girl on Hainam, Indian girl, and she was attracted by the kirtan led by Tribhuvanath. And I have to be close to the microphone. And so then she realized that she knew him from a long time before. And then, I don't anymore the details, but it's well reported. It came out that in her last life, she met Srila Prabhupada in the Bhaktivinoda manor as a Sankirtan boy. And Tribhuvanath was her Sankirtan leader. He was a Sankirtan leader. And then this boy came all the way from Edinburgh down to become initiated by Srila Prabhupada. And I don't know whether he became initiated or not, but on the way back, he had a car accident, and he died in a car accident, and was born in a Hindu family in London, and was that girl then became attracted to Tribhuvanath. He said, I know him, you know, and I don't, this precisely described how everything fell into place. He remembered this boy. You know, we all remember him, actually, because that was one of the first person who died in Krishna consciousness, who then was born in the form of a girl who became interested in Krishna consciousness and became a devotee. So Krishna's plans are inconceivable. And we are part of this plan. We are very fortunate. And in this life, we will do something. And if we are born in this material world again, we do something more. Because the stage is set for spreading Krishna consciousness. Now I want to turn to Bhaktivinod Thakur. Sorry that I got carried away a little bit, but it is setting the stage. So while you had this wonderful kirtan today, I sat on my computer to find something about the life of Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur. And so here it is. So he was born in 1838. He left the world in 1914, the beginning of the Second World War, First World War, beginning of the First World War. And it's stated here in this report, he was a pioneering spiritual leader, somebody who pioneered a whole movement, a householder. What you can do as a householder, not that you just sit and feed your babies, which is also necessary. At the same time, he had a lot of babies. He had 10 children. That's a lot of babies to feed. At the same time, he was a magistrate in the highest position under the British rule, a prolific preacher, writer, and poem. He wrote volumes of books, reintroducing the pure teachings of Lord Chaitanya at a time when these teachings had become lost. So the situation was that after Lord Chaitanya disappeared, gradually, the influence of his movement waned, you know, became dim, less and less. And one might wonder, why is this so? But it is so because, you see, it has to get worse before things get better again. My father always used to say, when it's getting worse, it's the beginning of things are getting good. And when it's getting really good, be careful, because that may be the beginning of it turns worse again, because this is how things work in the material world. So there had to be 2 centuries the influence of the movement waned. Sects of pseudo devotees such as Sahajiyas and similar groups had become prominent. And professing love of God but acting in base immoral ways. These groups brought disrepute upon the pure movement begun by Lord Chaitanya. Then Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur appeared. And he was born in rather opulent circumstances in Biranagara, or Bengali devotees would know where that is, and advanced himself all the way to the position of the magistrate of the British government in Orissa. And there he did some amazing things. He was writing all the time. He wrote his book, The Precepts of Lord Chaitanya, which was sent to McGill University in the year Srila Prabhupada was born. Prabhupada took this as a very important point, that when he was born, the book of Bhaktivinoda Thakur was put into the library of McGill University in Canada. Prabhupada took this as very significant, you know. So there was a mystic, Vishak Kishena, in Orissa, who was very prominent and acquired some mystic powers. He could produce fire from his head, which is quite a feat. You know, he had this mystic power. And he had declared, he became very prominent in Orissa and declared that he would drive off the British from ruling Orissa and he would become the king of Orissa. So people, you know, they follow this. You know, somebody is loud enough, barks loud enough, like this president, previous president of the United States, Mr. Whatever. He barks loud enough, he has many foolish followers. Prabhupada told us, when many small asses won't want to be the leader, that means he must be the biggest ass. Prabhupada said that. That's the logic. He must be the biggest ass. Otherwise, why would many small asses would vote somebody? And so he became the king. And he published his statements, and the British thought he should be eliminated because he is undermining British rule. But they passed a sentence that he should be arrested. The district governor of Bengal drew up the arrest order. Nobody there, no policeman dared to issue this order, to actually do this, to arrest him. They were afraid. You know, sometimes police is afraid. You know, just like when this Babri mosque was destroyed in Ayodhya, right? I was sitting on a television set in the home of an Indian life member in Delhi, and we were spellbound. I mean, I enjoyed every stone that fell from the roof of the mosque, I must tell. and so did he. He enjoyed like anything, you know, seeing that. And I prayed to Krishna that I would see them. I better not say that, you know. There are some other places which I would like to see being turned into temples again. So then, because it was done by a certain group of people, the RSS, right? An arrest was issued to arrest the representatives of the RSS in Vrindavan, who is actually in charge for the whole RSS in Mathura district, while at the same time he is a priest in the temple of Radharaman, one of the prominent priests. So he has his double role. On one side he's a priest, on the other side he's his officer. And so they issued an order to him. They called him and said, Maharaj, we come to arrest you in 2 hours. Please do not be home. Don't be home. You know, we come to rescue. And so in the same way, an order was passed that he should be arrested, but no policeman wanted to do this. You know, they were afraid of his power. And so then the commissioner for Orissa, Mr. Ravenshaw, asked Bhaktivinod Thakur to bring this Vishakhisena to justice. So what Bhaktivinod Thakur did, and it shows you how he was unafraid, like Prabhupada, unafraid, you know. He went and saw this Vishakhisena personally. And the yogi showed some powers that would normally scare off any ordinary man. Any ordinary man would run away, because see, this man is so powerful. Bhaktivinod Thakur was not impressed, and told him, I can see you have some yogic power in Tantra, but why don't you come to Puri? Because in Puri you could receive the blessing of Lord Jagannath, the famous deity of Krishna. So this fellow replied, why should I come to see Jagannath? He's only a piece of wood. I'm the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He said that, I'm the Supreme Personality. So Bhaktivinod Thakur became furious when he said that. He arrested the rogue immediately, brought him to Puri and threw him in jail, where he was guarded by 36 constables and 72 policemen. 32 constables, police officers and 72 policemen, high security. And he prosecuted him. The trial lasted 18 days. Thousands of people had gathered outside who were under the control of this yogi. And on day 6 of the trial, Bhaktivinod Thakur's daughter, Kandambini, became ill and died, nearly died. So he knew, Bhaktivinod Thakur knew that this was the power of the tantric yogi. And he said, let us all die, but this rascal must be punished. So he was so determined. Okay, even if we all die, he must be punished, because he is insulting Lord Jagannath. You know, like when Prabhupada saw any deficiency, that he saw that Krishna has been diminished, the desires of Krishna, or Krishna has been sidelined, he would roar like a lion. And I have personal experience of that. He would roar like a lion, he became extremely angry. You know, so he became very angry and put him in jail. And then he went into the jail himself, and he became sick. Bhaktivinod Thakur became very ill, high fever, exactly like his daughter. But he pronounced this man guilty and sentenced him to 18 months for political conspiracy. Then in jail, he went there and cut off his hair. This yogi had long hair. And because he was convinced that he drew his power from the hair. You know, he cut off his hair, and the yogi lost all power. He had not eaten anything during the whole trial. He fell to the floor like a dead man, had taken to jail by stretcher. After 3 months, he was moved to the central jail in Midnapur, where he took poison and died. He killed himself. An inglorious death. See the power of a pure devotee. He didn't budge one inch, even when his life was in danger, like Prabhupada. His life was in danger in so many ways, you know, so many ways, you know. Even after he came from the ship, he had another heart attack and was treated in hospital. And then the doctor, Indian doctor, he said to Brahmananda, this old man is praying too much. He should walk every day. And Prabhupada heard this and he laughed when he heard this. This old man is praying too much. But he should walk. So Prabhupada started walking. From that day on, Prabhupada, with determination, every single day he walked. You know? So he risked everything. And then let's go further. then he was praying to Jagannath, please send a ray of Vishnu to preach the message of Lord Chaitanya all over the world. And in this way, Bimala Prasad was born, who later was known as Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati. So he prayed for his one son. And when Bimala Prasad, Bhaktisiddhanta, was 6 months old, the Jagannath cart stopped right in front of Bhaktivinod Thakur's house in Puri. Couldn't move for 3 days. Nobody knew why. And so then finally, Bhaktivinod Thakur asked his wife to bring the child on the Rath cart to accept the mercy, get the feet of Lord Chaitanya, of Jagannath. And then a huge garland fell from Jagannath around the child. This child was born with his Brahman thread, with his umbilical cord that connects him to his mother, you know, around his neck, and then exactly how we care where a Brahman thread. He was born with a Brahman thread, practically speaking. And he was very determined, his son was very determined. Bhaktivinod Thakur chastised him that he ate an orange, a mango without offering. The child was only 4 years old. And the child decided with 4 years that he will never eat a mango again in his life. Think about that. You know, his life was pure. I mean, the life of normal people, even devotees, is a mixture of fault and glory. Prabhupada said, fault and glory. It's a mixture of fault and glory. There's some fault there, and there's some glory there. That's normal. Even in devotees, young devotees, normal. There's some fault, there's some glory. And one should never stop practicing to get away from the faults, so that one's life can become completely glorious. So, now, when he was later, he retired, Bhaktivinod Thakur. He asked for special permission to retire, and he moved to Suravi Kunj, which is on the other side of the Jalangi River. You know Mayapur, you go to Hooghly Ghat. There's a Ganga there, you can go by boat to Navadvip. And if you go straight, you can go to Suravi Kunj. That's where he was, and due to his influence, he could build a railway station all the way from Krishnanagar in front of his house. It's still used partially, you know, and there's an interest. ISKCON has actually presented a case to extend this railroad, revive it and extend it all the way over the river, over the Jalangi River, right into Sridharmayapur. And the Indian government is considering it, to revive Bhaktivinod Thakur's railroad, so that next time when you come to go to Calcutta, Howrah, you can take a train all the way to Mayapur Dam. That's the plan. You know, you just change train and go all the way into the Holy Dam without having a horrific car ride. And so this is all the work of Bhaktivinod Thakur. And last thing I wanted to say, that comes to my mind, that his son Lalita Prasad wrote on the schedule of Bhaktisiddhanta, he would go to bed at 7:30 and in the evening and get up at 8. It's half an hour rest, right? Then then he would rise and write every evening from 7, from 10 to 4. Then he would take rest, so he would first engage in his sadhana, then he would write from 10 to 4 in the middle of night. Then he would rise, wash his hands, chant Hare Krishna, 4:30, and write letters and read. 8:30 received guests. Again he took a quarter of an hour, take rest. And then 9:45, morning bath, breakfast of half quarter milk, couple of chapatis, some fruits, and go 9:55, almost 10 o'clock to court. And 10 o'clock he was in the court, 5 minutes later, 1 o'clock the court was finished, he went home, took bath and refreshed, 2 o'clock he returned to office, 5 o'clock he returned home to translate work from Sanskrit to Bengali. He'd take a bath, meal, couple of chapatis, half quarter of milk, and then from there he consulted his pocket watch and his evening began again. So it's just amazing. I mean, maybe 2 hours rest, no more. And Prabhupada was exactly like that. You know, Prabhupada hardly rested. You know, it's just inconceivable how these people can live like this and how they can do so much because of it, because of their high status, spiritual status, and also their high status of material conduct. And nobody can live like this, you know, writing books, running a court, the court sessions, from 10 to 1. And he was judged very quickly. You know, he had no question, there was no doubt, he knew exactly what to do. He wanted to say, okay. And somebody said something, he said, just be quiet, sit down, your sentence, this is your sentence. He would sentence, it was famous in British government, how he could sentence so many people in a very just way. Because he was a tool in Krishna's hands. If we are tools in Krishna's hands, we can do everything. And we are tools in the hand of our mind, we become diminished, and ultimately we may achieve a kingdom on earth, but we lose our spiritual life. That's a very expensive way of living. People have no idea, you know, they spend their whole life like the huge, really rich man, richest man in India, and establishes so many things, and buys so many things, and sells so many things, but ultimately, if he doesn't change in that sense that he would start donating to a worthy cause like Krishna consciousness, what will be his life and what will be his future? I'm not the judge, but this is what happens. You know, you lose everything. You think you're winning. This is material life under the influence of Maya. You think you're winning, but you're losing at every step. That's the situation. You know, and so people are on this road, on the fast road to success, from becoming rich to richer, even richer, even richer, and feel like gods. In the next life, they become dogs. You know, like one time, when we were walking in Sweden, there was a dog barking. And Prabhupada said, do you hear this dog barking? He said, yes. And then he said, you know, our prime minister, he became a dog in Sweden, which is an amazing career. You know, it's an if you think about it, in one life prime minister, in your next life, you become a dog in Sweden. This was revealed to Prabhupada by his godbrother Srila Swami, who met one of the biggest astrologers at that time in India. This is way back. We're not talking about one of the recent prime ministers, we're talking about way back. What kind of career is that? What kind of career is that? That you'll be the prime minister and then next life you'll be one of these dogs here in the street, stray dogs, you know. So, Hare Krishna. This is all I can say on Bhaktivinod Thakur and on the principles of how great souls achieve so many things which are impossible to achieve for materialistic people. They may achieve this, may achieve that, but I mean, how do you bring all these people, particularly in Western countries, you know, complete somebody preaches in the middle of the hippie generation, no meat, no fish, no eggs, no tea, coffee, alcohol, cigarettes, no sex. You know, it's just, and people follow that. This is inconceivable for karmis. Like we had this court, you know, this boy was arrested in court in Heidelberg, in the middle. He was arrested in our temple. He was a brahmachari. And police dragged him out of the temple like an animal. So I protested. He said, "Who are you?" I said, "I'm the temple president. Why are you taking this boy? Well, what's the reason?" He said, "We cannot talk about the reason because he's not just judged yet. You cannot, judgment has to be spoken, but the judge is looking for him. We have to arrest him. The judge wants to see him." So then next day this boy called and said, "My lawyer," government gives him a lawyer, sent him, the lawyer said that I should come to the court to say something positive about him. And so I went to this court. And so the judge said, "Mr. Brinkman, is there Mr. Brinkman?" He said, "Yes, I'm right here." He said, "I heard you want to talk about this boy to me before judgment." I said, "Yes." And so I said, Your Honor, the court, as far as I understand, the jail is there to correct people. Understand what he did? He smuggled some piece of hashish, not a big thing. Petty session court, not high court. He said, "Yes, that's true. It's for rectification." I said, "He's already rectified." He said, "How is that?" He said, "Well, we follow very strict principles. No meat, no fish, no eggs, no tea, coffee, alcohol, cigarettes, what to speak of drugs. No gambling. And no sex." "No sex," the judge said. He went up like this. "No sex." He said, "Only in marriage and then for producing children." The judge was in a shock. He said, "That is worse than hell. Take him with you. He is sufficiently punished." "Take him with you. Sufficiently punished." He was, and the whole court was applauding. You know, I mean, there were hundreds of people there. It's a petty session court who were supposed to be judged during the session of one day. They all clapped. They went to somebody, they all glorious to the judge. Somebody screamed because he was a good judge. He could understand, you know, he has given up everything. So what's the point of putting him in jail? For what? It's inconceivable to people. And Prabhupada preached that, you know, and people followed him by the droves. You know, leaving everything behind that they possibly had at that time. Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur ki jai, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Sarasvati ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Oh, one last thing I need to say. Bhaktivinod Thakur had a vision, two visions, but one of the visions that was that one day he saw into Mayapur, and he saw many, many foreigners, white-faced foreigners, singing in kirtan. And he said, you know, "When will this day come that Russians, Germans, Americans will join in Hainan?" Which came true then, 100 years later, you know. And another thing, he saw the huge temple rising, which was predicted already by Srila Nityananda Prabhu, that a huge temple will rise in Mayapur, and all that is happening. So, welcome to the club. All of you are very fortunate, myself also, and some or other, we could enter into the association of Srila Prabhupada and the Acharyas by being in the Hare Krishna movement. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.